Madhava Jaya Kunjabihari. Gopi Jana Balava Jaya Giri Varadhari, Jaya Giri Varadhari. Gopi Jana Balaba Jaya Giri Varadhari, Jaya Giri Varadhari. Jaya Radha Madhava Jaya Kunjabihari. Chashura Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana, Chashura Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana, Jai Shora Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Jai Shora Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Jamuna Tira Vanachari, Jamuna Tira Vanachari, Jaya Radha Madhava Jaya Kunjabihari. Jaya Vishnupada Paramahansa Pribrajakacharya Stuttara Sata Shishimara Stavangra Shla A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami Haraj Shla Prabhupada Ki ISKCON founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki, Ananta Koti Vaishnavarinda Ki, Nama Acharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki, Prem Segaho Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Dvaitika Radhar Shivas Arigaura Bhaktivarinda Ki, Shishi Radha Krishna Go Gopagopina Shamakunda Radha Kundigiri Govardhana Ki, Shri Vrindavan Dhamma Ki, Shri Mayapur Dhamma Ki, Ganga Mai Ki, Jamuna Mai Ki, Bhakti Devi Ki, Tulasi Devi Ki, Samaveta Bhaktivrinda Ke, Jainatai Gaura Premanandi. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to Shri Guru and Shri Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Mam vachobhi samaradhya lokanam ekam ishvaram paratrayam vrinite yo buddhiman dipa dashusham mam vachobhi samaradhya lokanam eka ishvaram paratrayam vrinite yo buddhiman dvipa dashusham mam vachobhi samaradhya lokanam eka ishvaram paratrayam vrinite yo buddhiman dvipa dashusham. That's for this. No. Mam, me, vachobihi, by sweet words, samaradhya, after sufficiently pleasing, lokanam, of all the planets in this universe, ekam, the one and only, ishvaram, master, controller, paratrayam, 3 feet, vrinite, is asking for, ya, he who, abuddhiman, not very intelligent, dvipadashusham, because I can give you an entire island. Translation. I am able to give you an entire island because I am the proprietor of the 3 divisions of the universe. You have come to take something from me and have pleased me by your sweet words. but you are asking only 3 paces of land. Therefore, you are not very intelligent. Purport. According to the Vedic understanding, the entire universe is regarded as an ocean of space. In that ocean, there are innumerable planets, and each planet is called a dvipa, or island. When approached by Lord Vamanadev, Bali Maharaj was actually in possession of all the dvipas, or islands, in space. Bali Maharaj was very pleased to see the features of Vamanadev, and was ready to give him as much land as he could ask. But because Lord Vamanadev asked only 3 paces of land, Bali Maharaj considered him not very intelligent. So this platform of intelligence is being discussed, and you have this, how Bali Maharaj is seeing. That he's seeing is that you could get so much from him because he's collected so much. So that means having so much, he can give so much. And so since you've approached such a wealthy person, why would you ask for such a small amount that you could get from someone else that's not so qualified as himself? Right? You know, anybody with a little bit of land, you know, could give Vamanadev 3 steps according to his own steps. It wouldn't be a burden really for anyone. So his point is now you've approached someone so great, why are you only asking for this? Because being so great, he could give so much. Right? Because it's pointed out, Vamanadev is behaving properly, he's dealing nicely, you know, it has that qualification, but being a Vatu, being young, then he's not so educated, he doesn't have the experience. So why would you ask for something so small from someone so great? So that's Bali Maharaj's angle. Then underlying that is Vamanadeva is asking only for 3 steps of land because he's saying that's all he requires. So it doesn't appear to be much. So that then is in contrast to Bali Maharaj, who has more land than he requires. He doesn't require the 3 worlds. It's not necessary for him. Right? It means whether he's just on Sutala, whether he has all the hellish regions, all 7 of them, whether he has the earth, whether he has the heavenly planets, it doesn't matter. He's still only going to eat the same amount of chapatis. It's not going to increase. It's not that each dvipa that he controls, then he starts to eat more and more like that. No, it remains the same. So that's the point, is that he doesn't require for his maintenance, for his duties. So just as Bali Maharaj is showing from his perspective, Vamanadev, Bali Maharaj is looking at it from his perspective. I have so much, you could get so much. Not that he's not thinking, I have more than I need, so because I have more than I need, you should be asking for more than you need also. Otherwise, why approach with a person with more than he needs? Right? So that's the ideas that we see, is that there's a difference in the consciousness here. But it's not that Bali Maharaj is not pious, in that he's performing sacrifices, he respects the Brahmins, he's giving in charity, he's, you know, willing to deal properly. Here, someone who's a child, instead of taking advantage of it, then he tries to help him realize what he could gain from that, get his best potential. So all these different aspects are there. And so he's trying. But unfortunately, because he doesn't have that transcendental association, then his perspective is not ideal. So now that he has that association of Vamadeva, the Supreme Lord, now he can develop, and we see he will develop, the proper attitude. So this is what we take advantage of in association. Bali Maharaj is thinking that the main thing to take advantage of is what you can get from the situation. You're in a good association. What can you get from that in the way of the external? What facilities I can engage? How can I improve my position? But we see Vamadev showing us, no, it's about the transcendental consciousness. So when you're with those who are more advanced, how can I gain transcendental understanding? That's the thing to gain. Right? We understand? Because that means you're inquiring, you're wanting to know, you're wanting to apply. Right? Because that's the difference. The jigyasu wants to know. He doesn't want to apply. Otherwise, why is he a jigyasu? Jigyasu means just one who is interested. He's interested in knowledge. Right? You know, you ever heard questions that are completely, have no meaning with anything, and you ask, why do you ask that question? Oh, it's interesting. That's the platform of jigyasu. It's not that it's going to be useful, it's just interesting. Right? Jnani means he's going to apply it. That's the difference. That's why Krishna in the Gita then explains how the jnani is the position that the neophytes should strive for. And then by being situated steadily in that, then they'll come to the Madhyama platform. But the other three platforms aren't very strong. So we see here is the jigyasa, he doesn't want to apply. So same way as the others, they just want to apply, but it's not necessarily connected to Krishna. That's the difference. Yeah. The jnani wants to apply the knowledge. The jigyasu, the arta artarti, just they want these material facilities. So, but even that, even though it's not the ideal, but if it's connected to Krishna, right, that's why they're mentioned, it's progressive. They will advance. But still one should know what the standard is. Right, this modern concept of no, everybody's great, we're all fine and all that, and be wonderful and be inspired and all these things, and don't worry and, you know, all these things. That's nice. It makes you feel good, but doesn't make you advance. Advancement means you have knowledge, you're engaging that knowledge, therefore you're getting the benefit of that knowledge. But if it's just I feel good, okay. That's why the artarti approaches the Lord, is to feel good. But then if we're approaching the Lord to feel good, we should feel good in connection with the Lord, not with what other materialists are saying. Right? Otherwise, then how are we in artarti? Right? Does that make sense? So that's the point, is that the connection to the Lord is what makes it special. So in the same way, as we see here in that association, that connection with the Lord, that's what makes association special. The material knowledge someone has, the material facilities they have, the ability that you can get something from that, that's not actually the main point. It's actually how you can benefit in Krishna consciousness. These other things can come on the side, that's not a problem. But if they're the main reason, if they're the overarching reason, then they'll always be a problem. Because as long as there's any material desire, there will be problems. So if we're thinking, I've been a devotee, why am I having problems? It's like I'm maintaining material desire. That's why it's mentioned. It means you have all the offenses. The last one is don't maintain material desire. Why? Because you'll suffer. Why? Because it's not pleasing to Krishna. Right? We're supposed to be attached to Krishna, not to something else. Does that make sense? So if we're all wondering, why is it I'm a devotee, I'm suffering so much, it just means that you're not suffering for the parts where you're a devotee, you're suffering for the parts where you're not a devotee. Does that make sense? The citizen is not punished by the government for what he does right. He's punished for what he does wrong. Right? So that we have facility, this, that. Now, we can say, no, but I'm not happy. I'm just miserable. The point is in the material world, you can't be happy. There's miserable and not miserable. These are your two options. Happiness is not an option. Right? One of the explanations of this, we hear of ananda, right? Which means we take bliss. And then sukha, which is happiness. So sukha is defined as removal of pain. So that's as good as it gets in the material world. You can remove pains. And so it'll be a neutral state. That's why it doesn't stand out much. The pains stand out because they're opposite of ananda. And the neutral state of sukha doesn't stand out to the soul because it's kind of a state of nothingness. Right? It means you only notice it when the pain comes up. And then when you remove the pain, you notice it. But after time, you forget because there's not supposed to be pain anyway. Right? So that's the thing, is that therefore we're focusing on something. Why am I suffering? So, we could ask, why aren't I in Ananda? Why aren't I in Ananda? Because that means absorption in Krishna. Why am I suffering? Because I'm absorbed not in Krishna. Right? But we see Krishna's very kind. Even there's all the suffering that Krishna's taking care of. Krishna's helping. It's not as bad as the karmis. We can say it is, because everybody will say, oh, no one knows, understands my position, and everybody in the room understands. It's just that person can't understand that everybody else understands. Like that. That's the weakness that's there. So here, then if we look at it from the spiritual platform, is that when you approach those who are spiritual, when you're involved in a spiritual movement and spiritual activities, you should take full advantage, which means to get the spiritual benefit. Right? We're in Mayapur, take advantage. It's not just another place. We're not living here because it's cheaper than living somewhere else. You know? That's not why we're living here. If we're here, it's because this is the spiritual world. We may or may not fully appreciate it, but we appreciate to some degree. Otherwise, why one is here? But it has to be that we're taking advantage of that, taking advantage of the association of Radha Madhava and the Pancha Tattva and all the, you know, Nrsimha Dev, Jagannath, all the forms that Krishna comes as, taking advantage of the Ganga Devi. Taking advantage of the opportunity to hear and chant, and that everything you do here, you get 1,000 times the benefit. Right? So all these things, this is what we should be taking advantage of. So, you know, from the instructions of Bali Maharaj, we can say, though he was looking at it from the materialistic, but the principle is the same. You approach someone with qualifications, according to that qualifications, that's how you should try to get benefit. So the spiritual benefit's the real benefit, right? And we can see here, Vamanadeva, his benefit he's looking for is not for himself, it's for the devotees. So therefore, then we're seeing what benefit we can do to please Krishna, to please the spiritual master, to please the Vaishnavas. That then makes it that we're taking advantage of the situation. So that's the whole point, is when you're actually without motive, then you can take advantage. And when you actually have motive, you can't take advantage. That's the fun part. That's just how Krishna's energy works, right? You know, it's fun. Okay. Is there any questions or comments on this? Yes. We have a mic. Ah, it's out there today. Very good.
Hare Krishna. Maharaj, I was wondering, what was Bali's motive in the first place to get the three worlds?
Bali's motive in the first place?
Why did he want more than he needs?
The same that everybody's. What every living entity wants. He wants more. Like when you go out into the... Like, I don't know, you don't see it here so much. But behind the Gurukul, then all that used to be rice fields. Most of this was. And then after you harvest the rice and you clear the field, then you can see all the holes that the rats are in. Now, some people would go in and dig in the holes there. And you could find as much as 40 kilos of grain in one rat hole. So, that's why. Just because you can. Right? In other words, how much does somebody try to get? How much they can? And if there's no opportunity, okay. Then they may be satisfied or dissatisfied, but they don't endeavor. But if they can, that's the material consciousness, that's greed. So it's only with training and purification that then we don't have greed. And so that's the whole idea in the Vedic culture. That's why Brahmins are on the top. It's supposed to be, there's no greed. And of the Brahmins, then it goes up in the qualification. The sannyasis, those who are who study and teach the scriptures. You know, things that don't produce facility. That's considered the top. And so therefore, karma's lower, renunciation's higher. So that's all within that the material sphere, is that how to reduce. Because if the top, if like the modern, we make the business people or the celebrities or, you know, these kind of people with all the facilities the top. Right? Because we may make, we may respect intelligent people. They might get a Nobel Prize or some other recognition. But very few people really think about them as a lifestyle choice. Does that make sense? So these other ones where you see that they have material facility, and not only you see that they have it, but they're using it. That's generally taken as the top. So those are the most greedy, most attached, you know, most controlling, most enjoying. We take, that's the leadership we want. The Vedic is the opposite. Because otherwise, if not, then people don't try to be. Does that make sense? They don't try to become detached from the material energy. So in the Vedic culture, then it's there. That's why he's classified in the group of the demons. Because they don't try to control these things. If they have an opportunity, they'll take it. Right? The demigods aren't trying to take over the lower heavenly planets, even though they have better facilities. They're happy where they are. But the demons, they have their facilities and they want more. So that's just the demoniac mentality. So it's standard. That's the way, you know, Prabhupada gives the example of you have a sack of rice. If you just put it out in an open field, birds will come, eat a little bit, squirrels will come, take something like that, rats will come, take a bit more, but the human will come and take the whole thing. So, you know, like that. Does that make sense? Yes?
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Forgive me if you've already covered the point. Speaking about that. In having it for yourself, and also striving to get more facilities.
How to get more facility for Krishna and stuff for yourself? You have to strike a balance.
And
what do you mean by balance? How are you defining balance here? Okay, so it's not for our own self, we're doing it for Krishna. The point is it means who's going to get the results of this endeavor? This endeavor, let's say when we're talking about an endeavor that gives some kind of facility that people like to have. Right? So then, but who's getting that benefit? Right? If we see it in your house and not in the temple, then is it hard to tell? Right? Does that make sense? And if, you know, if we see it, it's at the temple and not at your house, then that's more obvious that it's for Krishna, right? So that aspect is not so much the difficult thing. You go and do something, let's say, work hard to help for the Rath Yatra festival or something like that. So then in there, then it's for Krishna. And so the benefit is not that you're going to end up with this cool Roth cart in your front lawn as a, you know, conversation piece or something like that. No, it's going to work out that it's all nicely for Jagannath, right? So now, now the things come as there is now, are we trying to get some side benefits from that? Do we want recognition for this? Or are we trying to get some facility? Well, yeah, you know, I help with the Ratha Yatra, and because I do that, the Ratha Yatra festival is there, and so if I'm not here, the Ratha Yatra festival doesn't go on. But now the Ratha Yatra festival is only 2 weeks of the year, and okay, yes, we do take a few weeks before, so let's say 2 months of the year, then I'm working hard for this and that. And so for that to go on, so then the temple should take care of me for the other 10 months of the year while I do nothing, because I have nothing else to do other than that. But, you know, because I do such a fabulous service, I should be taken care of very well. Then you know, okay, that's not, there's something wrong here. Right? And then in our house, because for the devotee, then his life's supposed to be for Krishna, then it's a matter of, is it within your conditioning? Means, what is your conditioning? What does it require? And so then how much it requires to be able to be engaged in Krishna's service and the facilities required for what you can do in Krishna's service within your house, that's what you have. More than that, then that's what's above that. Does that make sense?
Somewhat.
Somewhat. Okay. Let's say you go to work, you go to the temple, and that's all that's happening in movement. Everybody else is staying at home or like that, or they have some other arrangements. Then you only need one car. Right? Now let's say you have to go to work, you have to go to the temple, then the wife has to go this and that also, and she has the things in her service, then you need two. Unless your schedule is stuff, you do everything in the morning, she doesn't need. But point is it's what can get by. In other words, if you never need to use two cars at once, then you only need one. Right? And if you're close to the temple, you can walk there, take a bus, then why have a car? Right? So it's just a matter of what do you require? Right? Now if it's there and then you have the, you know, daughter, then the son, and then like this and that, and so that way you need four cars, then you have four cars. But if not, you don't. So it's not that, well, you know, hey, this car is cool and that car is also cool and, oh, I'd like to have one of those. And, you know, like you have these guys that have money and then they got the Rolls Royce and they got the Hummer and then they got, you know, so
Maserati.
Yeah, that and, you know, all these other things like that. And you're from London, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, no, it won't work for you. I was going to say a Mini, but Indians don't care for Minis, so... I think you have to be a wasp for a Mini, right? Yeah. So like that, then you'll have all these cars that you don't require. You know what I'm saying? Like the rich lady with the big Porsche 4x4. She doesn't require it. It's a monster car. The amount of shopping she does or what she shops for, she can stick on the seat. It's so small because she doesn't do the groceries. That's what the maid does, right? They do that shopping. Right? You don't need the 4x4. It's hard to park. It's big. It's monstrous. It's meant for off-road. So she could get by with a Smart. But amongst the other ladies, that won't be cool if she shows up in a Smart. If she shows up in the Porsche 4x4, then that's cool. Right? But now, you know, Rolls-Royce makes a 4x4. So now you can show up in that, and then you trump the Porsche any day. Right? Like that. You understand? So as you don't require it. Does that make sense? Now, if you do require it, you do big things, you do big contracts and business and that, and people expect that if you have material facilities, you must be good. If they're looking at it, you have facilities, you're good, then you have to show for your business. At home, you don't. So your host might be, like if you never host these people at houses, you don't need a fancy place. But you might need a fancy car, fancy suit, this, that, because that's what they respect. But if you're in something that it doesn't require that at all, then you don't need it. So it's in other words, what's actually necessary for you to perform your duties and get the results that you naturally get from those duties? And then, according to that, that's how you live. In other words, doing your duties for the standard amount of time, which Prabhupada recommended 8 hours, then you live according to that. Then that's not beyond that. You're going beyond. You're working 12 hours. No, that's beyond. Then what for? Right? Those 4 hours, if you want to do something outside the family, then do it for the temple.
right? Because the point is whatever it is, you put in that 12 hours, it's not that you'll get more. Or if you are getting more, then where is it coming from? Because you only have a certain quota, so you're taking out of a future quota. So you want that? You know what I'm saying? Like you put your savings away, and then you're spending your savings. So in the future, will there be savings? No. So you're not going to get more than you deserve. So if you see somebody with lots of money doing all nonsense, well, he's getting more. Yeah, it's coming out of his savings. And in the future, he'll be that guy in the street, you know, asking for money. Does that make sense? Yeah. So like that, you judge, you try to understand. Yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. When Bali Maharaj was asked by Vamanadev to give three steps of land, did he knew that the Lord would be deprive him of all his possessions? And how did he react when he realized that he was deprived of all his possessions? And what does the Lord want to teach us by asking like that?
Well, one we'll see is this will all unfold as we go. Because this is, as the story is going, this is what's going to happen. The point is he, at this point, he doesn't know. So he's willing to give. And even then when Sukracharya points out what is going to be the situation, then his point is, as a Kshatriya, I've given my word, I have to stick to my word. And so therefore, for him, even if he loses everything but he maintains his word, that's more valuable than having everything and your word is not of any value. You know, because he's a Kshatriya. So even he does, he still goes ahead with it. And then when Vamanadeva does take everything and arrests him because he does all that in two steps, not three, then he's not feeling bad about it. So that's the whole point, is the devotee being surrendered to Krishna, then however things unfold, he doesn't blame Krishna for it. Because the point is we're not supposed to be here anyway. Does that make sense? You know, it's just like blaming the government that I'm having a tough time in prison when you're not supposed to be in prison in the first place. You can say, why am I suffering? Or why does the government allow this to happen? Or why are you in the prison? You know what I'm saying? The other citizens don't have that problem. Does that make sense? So that's the whole point, is that the devotee is not disturbed by this. So he's not. And then from that, then we see then he gets all glories, because then if he doesn't, and what's the problem? It's simply material loss. But by being absorbed in the Lord, is there any real loss? Because if you have Krishna, you have everything. So it appears externally that there's a loss, but we see is there isn't. It's just a matter of time. But it's Krishna's time, not our time. Our time is, we want everything yesterday, and Krishna's, you're going to get it tomorrow. You know, so there's that gap. So you can come to a compromise by doing everything at present for Krishna. And that's how you can balance the future of getting things and the past when you wanted them. Does this make any sense? Or? Yeah, so again, comes down to just, if we see things connected to the Lord, then all these external things have less importance. Their importance is simply as opportunities to do something for the Lord. You know, it's just like, let's say, if we make, let's say we refurbish the, you know, all the temple, and in doing so, we refurbish the deity kitchen. And in refurbishing the kitchen, we make, you know, really, really nice facilities. So now, for a devotee or a pujari seeing that, what does he think? Right? He'll think, I can do now so many nice things for Krishna. I can cook so many nice things for Krishna. So that's what he sees in that situation. Now, let's say somebody refurbished their own kitchen at home, right, with so many nice facilities. They might start thinking about what I can do to enjoy from this kitchen. You know what I'm saying? So it's not the external, it's not that the only benefit of it is its use in Krishna's service.
What is not clear for me is that at the beginning, Bali, it seems that Bali Maharaj did not know it was the Lord.
He doesn't.
He did not know. So he accepted to give, but he did not know that the steps would cover everything that he had. So
yeah, he didn't know. But Sukracharya then told him that's what's going to happen. So then he did know when he gave it. Because they were looking, oh, he didn't know, and so Vamanadeva tricked him. And so otherwise he might not have been so surrendered, because we say Bali Maharaj surrendered everything, right? He's the Atmani Vedanamwala, you know, but he wouldn't have surrendered everything if he actually known. So actually should he get that credit, you know? But the point is he did know when he gave, because Sukracharya told him. And then because Sukracharya was acting on the platform as the guru of the demons, and he being a demon and up to that point has always acted for his own personal benefit, Sukracharya advised him that way. And so, but he rejected that advice for the higher advice of surrender to Krishna and all that, that position. So that's why then he got that benefit. Now we could say is, okay, well, he didn't listen to his guru, rejected his guru. Yes, because the guru was just functioning on the material platform. So there's no advantage there. But we see afterwards, Vamanadeva will ask Sukracharya, was there actually any fault in Bali Maharaj for his having disobeyed him and, you know, given that charity? And Sukracharya said no. Because if you're looking at it in the context of him being a pure devotee, what he did was perfect. But Sukracharya is down there to, you know, take care of the demons who basically, except for, you know, him and Prahlad Maharaj, then they're all demons. They don't worry about these things. So he's just dealing with them how... you know, a Brahmin in their assembly would deal. But if you're actually looking at the absolute standard, then no, it was perfect what he did. So we see from the whole thing is that Krishna conscious attitude that comes out very nicely. Bali Maharaj did know what he was doing. He gets the full credit like that. So we can maintain him on the list of the yeah, is that, yeah, okay. Something else? Yes.
Hare Krishna. Maharaj, if there is some devotee who has a hidden motive, for example, he needs some post for Krishna service, but at the same time he is also attached to the facility. So if he continues to, or if he gets that post and continues to serve, is it that he gets purified of the motives, or...?
He can get purified of the motives. Means, in other words, he's interested in a post, but he wants to do that for Krishna, and he engages that in Krishna's service, then he'll get purified. Now, depending upon how much it is for Krishna, and how much he's taking advantage of whatever's the reason he wants the post, for the power, for the prestige, for the facility, or whatever it is, that will slow down the purification. You understand? So it's just, it's a matter of how does he apply himself. So as he performs the service, even he goes into it simply because of the benefits he'll get. But doing that service, the heart will become purified. So is he taking advantage of that purification? Is he changing his mentality? Is he seeing the opportunity to give up these attachments? Because Krishna will make them aware. In other words, what's the point of taking something away that you don't know about? You know what I'm saying? How are you benefiting? Like that? Does that make sense? So, because you've given it up for Krishna, then there's that benefit. Or, at least you'll act in a Krishna-conscious way, having been that's been removed. But by it being removed, then you take advantage for a pious position to get more material facility. Then we'll see that will just get in the way. That the weeds of that desire will choke the creeper. So it's just a matter of the opportunity to be aware of the opportunity to give up that desire will be there. So you take advantage, you'll move more quickly. You remain attached or, you know, don't want to give it up, then that's where your problems will start. So they may not be there at the beginning, they'll be there, you know. I mean, they'll always be there because you're attached. But you'll get purified. That makes sense. Yeah? So in other words, it's okay. It's not one of those, better to do nothing, you know, go home and just take care of your parents and be a nice guy than to do service in the temple with attachment. Don't try that kind of nonsense. People do try it. Don't do that. You know, they're better. The karmis are better. No, they're never better. There is not one day of the week or the year or the millennium where a karmi is ever better than anybody who has faith in devotional service. Never. Not one of them. Even Mother Teresa. You know, I say, God rest her soul, right? Yeah? It doesn't matter. Because the point is when you have faith and surrender, accept that God's a person, he has an eternal form, and therefore devotion is the way. That's the reason the material world's here for, is to come to that understanding. That you're progressing nicely, you're a great guy, you're a fabulous guy. That's nice. Karmis will laud that. Nowadays, devotees will laud that. Why? Because if you're nice, you'll be nice to them. And if you're not nice, you won't be nice to them. So is it actually about you being nice? No, it's about I don't want to be dealt with badly. You understand? Pranamoya is always about yourself. But you don't speak about yourself. You speak about everybody else. See, anamoya is I get it myself. Pranamoya is I'm willing to cooperate with everybody else and be a nice guy so that I get more. Right? Because if I do it myself, I'll get a certain amount. If I do it with everybody, I'll get more. So it's just extended sense gratification, but it sounds a lot better. It sounds fabulous. But we have to understand is underlying it's not that great. So we have to always be very careful of this, right? That it doesn't come up. Right? Does that make sense? Yeah. And so one might say, no, but then, okay, we're doing a very specific or specialized service here. It needs a certain kind of management or certain kind of knowledge and skill. So without that, we can't, let's say, hold the festival. Right? Somebody has a particular skill to, let's say, talk to the administrators within the city and get all the permissions and, you know, go out to the big guys and get all the money, or he knows how to organize and manage, or he has all the contacts where he can get all the facility, whatever it is. Yes, then that should be engaged by someone who's more advanced. It's not that because they can do that they should be the head guy. See, in the materialistic platform we take, who has the material skill should be in charge. No, it's who has the spiritual skill and knowledge and realization. They should be in charge. And the guy who has the skill, he should do that service as a service for Krishna. But the person in charge has to be able to relate to those skills so that he can encourage them and direct them in devotional service. So it's not just anybody can be. You understand? Does that make sense? So it's not that because you have the ability to do that service, then automatically you're in charge. No, you want to do that service? Do it for Krishna. Why do you need to be in charge to do it? Does that make sense? Like, there's plenty of businessmen and government politicians that have people that are hired. Like in America, managing the White House. That's done by a hired guy, not by the president. You know what I'm saying? So you could say he's managing the whole house and the president doesn't do anything. That doesn't matter. Just because you have the skill doesn't mean you're on the top. That's the modern perspective. And not to burst any bubbles, that's actually what the corporate world wants you to think. That because you have the skill, you're in charge. But remember, you have the skill, the maximum lever B is middle management. You will never be the CEO. You'll never be on the board. Why? Because you don't know what to do with it. Does that make sense? But they want you to feel good and that you are great and fabulous, and that's why they tolerate that you go around and harass all the guys on the lower level. As long as you get the work done and they can still do your work. They'll tolerate it. Because that way then you feel good and you work hard. Well, if you actually understood you're just a hired guy like everybody else, but you can do a little bit more, you have a specific skill, that's why you're paid a little bit more. But otherwise, that's it. You're nothing more special than anyone else as far as an individual goes. Then people aren't inspired. Right? So it's like the questions before. You know, unless you're catering to you know, lust, anger, greed, envy, attachment, and illusion, then people aren't inspired. So for the devotees, they don't have to do that. That's the benefit. So that's why then, if we're not motivated, then someone who has that, then they can do so nicely. So it's a matter of the attitude. I've heard of temple presidents, one temple president, I think he was only like 3 months in the movement. But because of the sincerity and all that, he could do it. And others that had skills that knew more, they would do it. So, you know, they would do the pujari work or this or that. Because of the sincerity. So it can be done. But you see, the point is it's the surrender to Krishna that makes it special. Right? That's the whole point. So, yes, the skill can be used, can be engaged, but it's not actually what makes the festival work. The original Ratha Yatra, they just hired a flatbed truck and stuck Jagannath on there, right? Jagannath's facing one way, Baladev one way, and Subhadra one way. And they just, you know, tied him onto the back of the truck. Big truck, just them there, no flowers, no garland, no nothing. I don't even think they wore clothes in those days. Right? And then they just drove down the street and did kirtan. That was it. And it was success. People became devotees. So it's not that, oh, we have bigger carts, that's why we make more devotees. Right? Does that make sense? Yeah, that's not how it works. If you're sincere, that's why it works. Is that okay? Yeah. So you just have to balance. Anything else? Yes. Where do you get? Oh, it's going. Here, take. He who dares wins.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. So we see that when sometimes it is easy to surrender to Krishna because we have no other option. It's disaster in our life.
Yeah,
like that.
Yeah, like Bali Maharaj.
But after, what is the advice to develop and to maintain this mentality of to be surrendered to Krishna?
How to cultivate or maintain the surrender to Krishna?
Yes.
Okay. Because it means, are you putting that in a context of sometimes situations are favorable for surrendering and sometimes they're not? Meaning here, if that is not nice, it's good for surrendering. When it's nice, then you forget.
Yes, and also in the progression of our spiritual life.
Yes, progression. It's just a matter of it's time. Because in this, we're dealing with the time factor here. So we'll either figure it out today or tomorrow. And if we figure it out today, then tomorrow we have that benefit. If not, then tomorrow we'll benefit, and then today we'll have the problem. So it's when you surrender, that's when things work. Situations changing, that's not actually what we're looking for. And that's not defined as how the mechanics work. Not being disturbed by the situation, that's actually the advantage of Krishna consciousness. Like Bali Maharaj is not, you know, we'll see, will not be in a great position. But he won't be disturbed. That's the thing. So this idea is, no, material world should mechanically function perfectly. It's like, since when is that one actual happiness? We say it is, but even for people who is working, we're not seeing that they're happy at those moments. And two is, since where does it say that that's how Krishna consciousness works? Right? If we're thinking that, we're looking at it from the point of karma. Because karma as religion then means I do good work, I get good results. So, but the point is Krishna consciousness is beyond this material karma. So I may do good work, but I'll get Krishna consciousness. Right? So it appears that it's not so viable. It would be just like, let's say, if you were working here and you're doing some small job, you know, like let's say I don't know, just something. You swept the veranda. And so then, and you're doing it as you know, expecting payment. But you're here, you live here, you know, all your expenditures in rupees. But they pay you, let's say, in euros. Right? So now it appears that, well, I can't use these here. Yeah, no, you can't. But you can use them there. Yeah. You understand? So that's the whole point. And what you're getting is so much more. You know, like let's say here you get 100 rupees, but we give you 100 euros. You can't compare them. Does that make sense? So that's what's going on, is that we're expecting to get it in rupees. But Krishna's giving it, you know, in the spiritual currency. We want it in material currency. He's giving it in spiritual. You want it material, you can have it, but material things will always give you problems. So even if you get it, it will still give you problem. Because we say, oh, I have no place to stay. If I only had a place to stay, then you know, everything would work out. But then you have the place to stay. Now you got to pay the, you know, the rent, the electric bill, you know, all this and that. The current goes off because it's, you know, West Bengal, and the guys down there in front of the switch that are getting paid have to move the switch a few times a day so they feel I did something for my money, you know, and like that. And so that then these things are going on. You know, the neighbors, then they love loud kirtans and all that. So when they're cleaning the house, then they turn on Aindra, open all the windows and all that, and turn it up full blast. You know, all these things that they're doing. And so now we're having problems. But before you said, no, all if I had a house, a place to stay, I would be happy. Now you have a place. Why aren't you happy? Right? Yeah, but now it's a studio. I need a one bedroom, you know, like that. No, I have a one bedroom. I need a two bedroom. I have two. I need a three. I need a three. I want a four. I have a four. I want a house. You know? Yes, it just keeps going. There is no end to it. So even you have the whole building and you're renting it and you live on the top floor and you got your flat for free because you sold all the other apartments. Still, you're miserable because you have to take care, because every time something goes wrong, they knock on your door. And even if you hire a guy, that he sits down at the bottom in an office and takes care of all that, he still has to get paid and he has to come with you with all the problems. You know, this whole building, you saved money and you wired it with a, you know, aluminum wire, and now it's all going bad. You have to replace it. Like that. That's going to cost you money. And now if you want to do it again after 10, 15 years, replace it with aluminum. If you don't want to replace it ever again, do it with copper. That'll cost you, you know, 10 times as much. So like that, then, you know, that's just the way it works. So whatever you have, there's a problem. Indra, he's king of heaven. People just want to go to the heavenly planets. Here, Indra is king of heavenly planets. And while he's sitting there enjoying, Bali Mars walks in with his army. That's definitely going to be a downer for your day there. It's not going to go down in your diary as one of your best days, right? You know. So that's the whole thing, is that it's, and even Bali Mars isn't walking in. No one's giving you any trouble. Indra, by his own pride, insults his own guru, and then, you know, does that make sense? You know, so this is just how it works, is that adiatmic, adibhotic, and adidaivic will happen. So if the adidaivic stop, then you know the adibhotic are there. You get rid of the adibhotic, you will make trouble for yourself as adiatmic. So guaranteed you'll get trouble. It's just a matter of who gives you the trouble. Like that. Does that make sense? So surrendering to Krishna, if we understand this, then whenever we are conscious of it, we'll take advantage. That's the whole idea. That's the point of knowledge. Knowledge is not that the knowledge will create the Krishna consciousness. The knowledge is there so when opportunities for Krishna consciousness are there, you take it. Like let's say for example, I find I don't need as much material facility. You know, like say before that idea, I don't need such a fancy car. So then you downsize to a lesser car. Now friends say, why are you doing that and all that? No, it can all be used in Krishna's service. Why are you doing that? You know, what about the prestige? What about this, that? And all, you know, just so many things they may be saying. So now you might think, oh yeah, no, I could use, I'd listen to that, but it's not necessary. So you might get distracted. Or you can think, no, I actually, according to the thing, according to understanding of how, I don't need it. And if the friends don't, you know, appreciate it, you know, maybe time to get some new friends. You know, you can downsize all kinds of things. So that's the whole thing, is it's, then you see, then you take advantage. Otherwise, then you wonder, why is this happening to me? You know? Before I wanted this and I have no taste in this. Why there's no taste in this? I'm not happy. Because it can't make you happy in the first place. Be happy there's no taste. That means now you can focus on spiritual things. Right? You understand? When a materialist loses taste in everything, they kill themselves. You know, or try, you know, a whole new lifestyle, or you move to the other side of the planet, or they do something extreme to try to squeeze more taste. And if they can't, then they're very... But for us, as we lose taste in the material, then we're happy because now we just increase in the spiritual. But if we don't know that, then we'll be miserable. So that's why knowledge is there. But it's not that having the knowledge is what makes you Krishna conscious. It's taking advantage of the knowledge that makes you Krishna conscious. Using it for Krishna. Right? Is that okay? Okay, so we'll end here. Time's, unfortunately, we've run out of time. Granturaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Samaveta Bhaktivinda ki, Jainatai Gaura Premanandi.